Welcome everyone to this celebration of the life of Alex Stoll. My name is Marilyn Westfall, a longtime friend of Lynn and Mark's. Both Alex and his sister Erin attended this church as children, and they were active in the religious education program. And some church members here today have fond memories of them, and I hope that later on people who remember Alex will come up and share those memories. Unitarian Universalists do not embrace a unified theology of beliefs about what comes after death. But we know that every person has a unique life and offers something to the world that will never exist again. When someone dies, our sadness and grief are consequences of our love for that person, emotions that cannot be denied. On occasions like this one, we gather to receive comfort, share memories, and find support. We believe that love is stronger than death. Perhaps for many of us, it is as Mahatma Gandhi said, "There are no goodbyes for us. Wherever you are, you will always be in my heart." Among those here today to support love for Mark, Lynn, and Erin, our family members, and Cherry, Erin's partner, we're so happy, and we hope that we can take time to introduce you later on in the service. And we hope the service provides you with some comfort. I want to mention before we proceed the Alex Stoll Foundation. Mark and Lynn have founded the Alex Stoll Foundation for the support of young engineers with a passion for aviation, but without means to attend college or conferences. They hope you'll donate, not only to keep Alex's memory alive, but to let others share his passion for aviation. And your donation will honor his generous spirit. You'll find the QR code on the last page of the order of service and use it to make a direct donation with your smartphone, or go to the website below the QR code at cfscc.org/Alex Stoll. Gail Madison will now read our opening words. She's been long dedicated to this church, especially the religious education program, and that benefited both Erin and Alex.
Seasons and Cycles by Maria Mitchell. Small as is our whole system compared with the infinitude of creation, brief as is our life compared with the cycles of time, we are so tethered to all by the beautiful dependencies of law that not only the sparrow's fall is felt to the uttermost bound, but the vibrations set in motion by words that we utter reach through all space, and the tremor is felt through all time. Liz Davidson, a good friend of both Mark and Lynn, has lighted our chalice. This chalice serves as a symbol of community. Our chalice lighting words, which are included in the order of service, will be read now, and if you feel comfortable, you can read them along with me. Life is a Gift by Marjorie Montgomery. Life is a gift for which we are grateful. We gather in community to celebrate the glories and the mysteries of this great gift. I'd like now to invite Sylvia Ashby, another good friend to Lynn and Mark, to read Alex's biography, which was written by his parents.
Thanks, Gail. Good afternoon. Alex was born on November 1st, 1985, in San Francisco, and moved to Austin in 1987 and Lubbock in 1997. He attended Preston Smith Elementary, Gavassos Junior High and graduated from Lubbock High in 2004. He earned a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from Rice in 2008 and a master's and engineer's degrees in aerospace engineering from Stanford in 2011. Alex's lifelong passion for airplanes led him to research the design of quiet propellers. This led him to Joe Ben Bevert, who in 2011 hired Alex as the first full-time employee at the startup Jovi Aviation in Santa Cruz, California. This began a remarkable partnership between two passionate, brilliant engineers who between them pioneered the field of electric power, vertical takeoff and landing aircraft. Alex had, to his credit, 24 patents and several papers that are ranked as the best ever written on electric aircraft design. Joe Ben, Alex, and a team of brilliant engineers created the successful company that has grown today to nearly 1,500 employees and is on its way to flying its first passengers in its innovative aircraft in 2025. Alex embraced life with an infectious enthusiasm. He was fun-loving, adventurous, fearless, inspired, colorful, and kind, and had a ready laugh. His scores of friends live around the world. He traveled often. Each week might find him dancing, listening to live music, going to parties, and organizing and curating the playlist for happy hour at 5 p.m. on the dot on Fridays at Joby. He hated boring clothes and had a distinctive personal style. He enjoyed dressing up with a date for the annual Edwardian Ball or the Dickens Fair. He was a regular at Burning Man. For his birthday, he and his friends would gather at the ancient Egypt-themed Isis Oasis in the Napa Valley wine country and go wine tasting in a limo. The tops of his 2012 BMW or 2020 special edition Mazda Miata convertibles were almost always down. He was an inspired photographer, played guitar and piano, and he was excited to be taking flying lessons. Alex will be missed most of all by his family, with whom he was very close. Every year he joined family gatherings at Christmas and in summer in Colorado. To Alex's family, his death is the devastating loss of a beloved son, brother, nephew, and cousin. Gail and I will read two tributes to Alex, one by a colleague, the other by a friend. Mark shared them with us. They are edited for time, but you can read other tributes on the bulletin boards in the fellowship hall just outside there. I'll begin with a tribute by Julianne Farron, a colleague of Alex's at Joby Aviation. Alex passed away yesterday morning following a car accident. Sometimes there simply aren't enough words to describe our feelings and today is one of those times. Alex joined Joby in its very earliest days as our first ever full-time employee, and for more than a decade, set the example to all of us. In many ways, he defined Joby culture. He is someone who, on the same day, would devise an entire new aircraft concept from scratch, organize new business cards for the team, and then hang out with team members until the end of the night. He built the tools of our technical foundation, and his dedication to happy hour at 5 p.m. on Friday afternoons formed our cultural foundation. His benevolence and brilliance had no limit. His presence at industry conferences were rewarded with rooms that were overflowing with people eager to hear his thoughts. Many of our team enjoyed listening to Alex deliver the most comprehensive history of vertical flight that has ever existed. He left an indelible mark on our company and our hearts. Alex, you were and always will be Joby's number one employee.
I'm sharing a tribute from Megan Tsai, Alex's close friend, whom he met at Stanford. I lost a very good friend a little over a week ago. One day, we were texting as we routinely did, and the next he was gone without a warning. It's been painful to not be able to tell him how much his friendship means to me. We met my first month in grad school, September 2010. I was waiting in line for free food. I think it was a noodly thing. The line was somewhat long, and we were standing next to each other. He looked like someone easy to talk to. Maybe something about how his eyebrows are open. I don't know. So I struck up a conversation. It was immediately easy to talk to him. Alex had all the markers of a good friend. We had fun together. We trusted each other to share vulnerabilities and insecurities. We liked doing a lot of the same stuff. And for me, Alex thought in a way that brought up new and interesting perspectives. He also had a way of looking at events in the best possible light. I loved listening to him talk about friends, always in awe and excited in their success. Alex helped me grow in many ways, thanks to his inclusivity and his happiness to share experiences. He encouraged me to take a social dance class and was a really fun waltz partner. He introduced me to the national parks of Pinnacles and Yosemite and brought me on my very first backpacking trip. Somehow, he got me to go to parties strapped up in a pastel unicorn onesie. We hiked along the Lee River from Yangshou to Jingping and woke up at 4 a.m. for sunrise hikes. Thank you, Alex, for making my world so much bigger. I think he is still very much alive in us, in the way that he is inspiring us with the way he lived. He embodied so many beautiful traits, and he'll always be in my memory as an example to live by. We will now present a musical interlude, a duet sung by Mark's brother and niece, John and Mara Stahl. They're performing That Lonesome Road, written by James Taylor.
I'm going to read a poem by Ellen Bass. The thing is, she's poet laureate from Santa Cruz. The thing is, to love life, to love it even when you have no stomach for it. And everything you've held dear crumbles like burnt paper in your hands, your throat filled with the silt of it. When grief sits with you, its tropical heat thickening the air, heavy as water, more fit for gills than lungs, when grief weights you down like your own flesh, only more of it, an obesity of grief, you think, how can a body withstand this? Then you hold life like a face between your palms, a plain face, no charming smile, no violet eyes. And you say, yes, I will take you. I will love you again.
Thank you, Sylvia and Gail. We're now going to present a slideshow of Alex's life that Lynn and Mark have put together. What a vibrant life. In putting together this service, we decided to use California poets because, you know, this is where Alex really found his second life. And this is a poem by a poet named Dana Goya, who was the previous state poet laureate of California. He too lost a son, and he wrote a poem about finding resiliency by planting a tree. And in this case, it was a sequoia. So this is Dana Goya planting a sequoia. All afternoon, my brothers and I have worked in the orchard, digging this hole, laying you into it, carefully packing the soil. Rain blackened the horizon, but cold winds kept it over the Pacific. And the sky above us stayed the dull gray of an old year coming to an end. In Sicily, a father plants a tree to celebrate his first son's birth, an olive or a fig tree, a sign that the earth has one more life to bear. I would have done the same, proudly, laying my new stalk in my father's orchard, a green sapling rising among the twisted apple boughs, a promise of new fruit in other autumns. But today we kneel in the cold, planting you, our native giant, defying the practical custom of fathers, wrapping in your roots a lock of hair, a piece of an infant's birth cord. All that remains above earth of a firstborn son, a few stray atoms brought back to the elements. We will give you what we can, our labor and our soil, water drawn from the earth when the skies fail, nights scented with ocean fog, days softened by the circuit of bees. We plant you in the corner of the grove, bathed in western light, a slender shoot against the sunset. And when our family is no more, all of his unborn brothers dead, every niece and nephew scattered, the house torn down, his mother's beauty, ashes in the air. I want you to stand among strangers, all young and ephemeral to you, silently keeping the secret of your birth. We'll now see a video presentation by Harvey Madison, and in it is included a tribute by Eric Lassen, who runs Joby's integration team and is a pilot.
Hello, I'm Harvey Madison, and I'm privileged to do a reading from Eric Lassen, along with a poem. And I've recorded this because doing it in person, I may not be able to hold it together. Alex and I had a common interest and passion for aviation and flying. Here's Eric's tribute. When I first visited Joby, I hadn't yet decided if I was going to join the team, and I found myself on a ledge in the quarry, waiting to watch my first prop spin attest on one of Joby's earlier airframes. Among the small group of watchers, I quietly listened from the sidelines, trying to get a feel for the team. Most of the small team that was gathered on that hot day looked a part of the average unshowered, unshaved Santa Cruz lumberjack types. But one guy stood out. He was a smallish. His hair was combed and almost slicked. He was clean-shaved and well-groomed. He was wearing a fancy outfit with a sport coat. He was wearing fingerless gloves. Despite all of the above, the element that stood out the most was his fancy, bright red suede loafers. I watched him as the group approached, and he was methodically negotiating his way through the quarry to the viewing area, gently stepping around mud puddles and pointy rocks with his fancy shoes. I thought to myself, whoa, who is this guy? I imagined that he was perhaps a hotshot investor type. He was obviously popular and important to the team because after the test, everyone there watching was eager to talk with him and hear his thoughts of what we had all just witnessed. I'm embarrassed to say that my original prejudices assumed that someone who dressed so fancy would be pompous and self-important. What a surprise it was, as I got to know him over the following years, that he was one of the most kind, caring, and non-self-important people ever. I love airplanes and all aircraft. I love them as an art form, as a history, and as a science. Alex was a kindred spirit. Amongst the average public, I feel I even consider myself somewhat of an expert. If at one time I thought I was obsessed, Alex's knowledge, depth, and insights were on a level all his own. He is truly an enigma. Not just airplanes, but music, astronomy, cars, photography, food, movies, travel, and adventure were all topics that I enjoy discussing with and learning from with Alex. Like the clothes that he wore, Alex sparkled as an engineer, as a designer, as a person. When an aviator dies, the poem below is well used. Despite its common use, I still love it. I read this poem hundreds of times. I have read this poem hundreds of times. Interestingly, as I read this poem again today, I have a new perspective about the stanza that says, quote, "Wheeled and soared and swung, high in the sunlit silence, hovering there, I've chased the shouting wind and flung my craft through footless halls of air," unquote. I've never thought about that statement deeply before, but it now has added meaning because of Alex's dedication, passion, and vision. We will all someday, soon, have the opportunity to just sit and hover there. As a tribute to his vision and talent, I can't think of a better tribute than to work together as a team of friends and build and fly the airplanes that he dedicated his career and talents to. Alex, I will miss you. The airplanes we are building are your legacy. I'm glad to have been your friend. I Fly by John Gillespie McGee, Jr. Oh, I have slipped the surly bonds of earth and danced the skies on laughter-silvered wings. Sunward I've climbed and joined the tumbling mirth of sun-split clouds and done 100 things you've not dreamed of. Wheeled and soared and swung, high in the sunlit silence. Hovering there, I've chased the shouting wind along and flung my eager craft through footless halls of air. Up, up the long, delirious, burning blue, I've topped the windswept heights with easy grace, where never lark nor ever eagle flew, and while with silent, lifting mind, I've trod the high, untrespassed sanctity of space, put out my hand and touch the face of God. Speaking for myself now, Alex knew of my own love of flying, and Len and Mark have over the years proudly reported to me his impressive accomplishments at each stage of his career. It was a bright, I dare say brilliant one, powered by a mind filled with intelligence and curiosity and enthusiasm. Goodbye, Alex.
Yeah, for our final reading, I invite Liz Davidson, a good friend of the family, to come forward and read a poem by Mary Oliver, When Death Comes.
When death comes, like the hungry bear in autumn, when death comes and takes all the bright coins from his purse to buy me and snaps the purse shut. When death comes, like the measle pox, when death comes, like an iceberg between the shoulder blades, I want to step through the door full of curiosity, wondering, what is it going to be like, that cottage of darkness? And therefore, I look upon everything as a brotherhood and a sisterhood. And I look upon time as no more than an idea, and I consider eternity as another possibility. I think of life, of each life, as a flower, as common as a field daisy, and as singular. And each name, a comfortable music in the mouth, tending as all music does, towards silence. When it's over, I want to say, all my life, I was a bride married to amazement. I was the bridegroom taking the world into my arms. When it's over, I don't want to wonder if I have made of my life something particular and real. I don't want to find myself sighing and frightened or full of argument. I don't want to end up simply having visited this world. And I want to add personally that Alex, of all people, would have stepped through the door full of curiosity. That he most certainly took this world in his arms from the time he was born, and that we know he made of his life something particular and something real.
Or anyone, especially friends and family, wanting to speak of Alex, you know, open the service to those comments.
That picture of him sleeping reminds me that guy could sleep anywhere. Try to get through this. I'm Finn, or Aaron, as most of you know me. Alex was my brother. Alex had all of the main character energy, but none of the main character attitude. He was always just unabashedly his own person. Growing up, we weren't really close. We lived in completely different worlds. But as adults, we really started to build a relationship and find things to bond over. Turns out we did have things in common. I picked up guitar, he picked up guitar. I started making homemade waffles. He got a super fancy waffle recipe that uses yeast. A little bit of competition, maybe. He had crazy fun fashion and inspired me to wear less boring clothes. We never talked about it, but I think we inspired each other or competed against each other, depending on who you ask. But I know whenever I see something that is absolutely wild and unique, I'll think of him. I'm not... I'm not a spiritual person, but I feel like whenever I wear a funky outfit or take a great picture or go on an adventure, that he'll be there with me. I missed you, big brother.
This is hard. But it's it's important to be able to talk about him. So this is Alex's funeral. You're wearing a hat. Where are your hats? I hope you're not wearing boring clothes. That's this. I'm trying not to wear boring clothes. Funereal, but with that dash of Alex something or other. This is a tie Alex gave me. Where else am I going to wear a red tie covered in Chinese characters? Not very many appropriate venues for that. Also, I'm wearing a hat that Alex, I think, would have really appreciated. But I ordered it. It's a handmade hat from Santa Fe Hat Company, a Monte Cristi hat. I ordered it after Christmas, and it came, it takes about 6 weeks to make, so it came just after the car accident. So, but his clothes were all bespoke clothes. He always had these, and not handmade, but made to order shirts and pants. And so he loved just, interesting clothes. So I had to wear a hat for Alex. This is an event that's, all of you know pieces of Alex, parts of his life. But only a parent sees the whole. From that first moment when you hold the newborn in your hands, and 37 years later, the patch of ice, and a policeman knocking on the door at night, and it's over. So I'm just going to talk about a few things that I remember of Alex, various stages that seem to be Alex. Beginning with that first moment, actually, he did not cry in the delivery room. He was quiet. I think he at first had a kind of, that was weird, kind of expression. But he just opened his eyes. I can still now see him looking around the room, What is this? As if you just sort of entered an alien landscape with all these strange creatures, But he's taking it all in very quietly, absorbing everything, and he never stopped absorbing. So as a toddler, his name, as most toddlers, Alex's name is full of things that are hard for a toddler to pronounce. They couldn't say his own name. It was Allie. When he was little, we used to read him Richard Scarry books. Those of you from his generation all read Richard Scarry books. And it was about, most of them had to do, well, of course, with a character named Lowly Worm. And I forget the other characters. There was also a family that they usually focused on called the Cat family. Mom Cat, Dad Cat, Huckle Cat, and Sally Cat. And was reading it one time, he just had this broad grin, pointed to himself, and said, "Alley Cat." I just thought that was delightful. And I see Jobin is here. Jobin's got a childhood nickname, Joby, which became his company's name. Alex was Alley Cat to me. For years, until I think about first grade or so, I don't know what happened, but all of a sudden he's like, "I don't want to be Alley Cat anymore," which I thought Alley Cat would be a great nickname. I was like a jazz musician or something, right? Kind of cool. But he never wanted to be Alley Cat again. And I would remind him every so often when I thought, maybe Do you want to? No, no. Not going to be Alley Cat. He's always Alley Cat to me. Then he became a big brother. He was 3 and a half. And just after 4, I think he began to wonder how it was that he was not an only child anymore. And where did this sibling come from? So he asked me, you know, where do babies come from? Well, okay. Every parent is like, okay, this question is coming. He's 4 years old, doesn't really want to know everything, right? So, and all the baby books, and the parenting books tell you, you know, give them the basic and don't just answer the question. Don't go into great detail. They probably didn't want to know that. If they do, they'll ask you. So, okay, fine. So I just like, the daddy puts the seed in mommy's tummy and it grows into a baby. It's like, that's not enough for Alex. What is the seed like? Is it hard? No. So just answering his question as honestly as I possibly could, I described the seed. And then he's like, where does daddy keep the seed? How does daddy get the seed into mommy's tummy? Through the belly button? He's like, no. So by the time of all these questions, of course, Curious Alex had the whole story, far beyond the detail I would ever thought appropriate for a 4-year-old. So after describing it, he thought about it for a minute, and he said, that's disgusting. I suppose, from a four-year-old point of view, it really is. So, let's see. I'm not remembering everything. Okay. All right. On the table over there, with the pictures and stuff, I think is a little story that he dictated to me in second grade. The one about the Terminator monks. Did you read it? It's pretty crazy. He had a pretty crazy imagination. He was quick to memorize things. You know, I read to him when he was a preschooler. A couple childhood books are just delightful. One of them called It Could Be Worse by James Stevenson. I don't know if you've read It Could Be Worse. He loved that story, and he had it absolutely memorized. And everybody who knew Alex, you know, he would speak at the edge of human ability to understand, the speed with it he spoke, right? If he spoke any faster, it would break the sound barrier, I think. Even then, he spoke really fast. But he dictated this to me. I typed it up for him. But he had this, anyway, he memorized that. He memorized also how many trucks could a tow truck tow, which I've partly memorized. How many trucks would a tow truck tow? 1, 2, 3, 4? I don't know, but I'm sure than a little tow truck that a tow needs a tow when it's down on its luck, and on it goes. Anyway, he had that whole thing. It's a nice rhyme. He had that whole thing memorized. So he was reading very early. In second grade, Jurassic Park came out. And of course, every little boy in first second grade is into dinosaurs. He knew them all. He could pronounce their names correctly. It was just a little encyclopedia of dinosaurs. So I had to know to see that. So he wanted to read the book. It's a Michael Crichton book, you know, yeah. That thick. So I gave it to him, not sure it would, how far would he get in it. He read the whole thing. It took him months, but he worked his way through it. He later said, I didn't really understand a lot of it. I suppose about the butterfly wings and the random, the chaos theory and all that, but the dinosaurs eating people, he probably was read that. So after he read the book, then it's okay, we'll go to Jurassic Park in the movie theater. I'm not sure. It might be a little scary for a second grader, so we'll sit in the back. We sat in the back row near the exit. If it gets too much for you, just let me know. No, we were there the whole time. And afterwards, it's like, we should have sat further up. So, we put some of his early drawings about airplanes out front, because he was drawing airplanes very early. He loved airplanes from grade school, at least, fascinated. And so we were going, one of my memories of growing up, him growing up, is taking him to every air show that came along. So we lived in Austin, we'd go to the air show at what was then Miller Air Force Base, and then came out here, we'd drive all the way up, it's an hour and a half, to Clovis, for the military Air Force Base, that have an annual show. He would go to this little tiny airport just outside of Lubbock called Slayton Airport. Did you come with us? You came too, right, Jonathan? What's that?
So I was going to tell a story about this.
Okay, well, I'll let you tell the story about Slayton Air Show. It also went down to, what's the air, is it Dias down in Abilene? Went down there, so every air show we had to go to. He also, I think, had a competition with you to collect airline safety cards. You know, the cards that you'll find in the seat back pocket in front of you, a safety card, which will tell you what to do in an event of emergency. Well, every different kind of airplane has got the different safety cards. So I, of course, go on all these conferences all over the place. I collect safety cards, bring them back, not steal them out of the seat back pocket, because it seems kind of, let some person in an event of emergency, where's my card? but ask them, you know, do you have any extras? I can bring my son who collects safety cards. And usually they were like, sure. Well, go see if I can find an extra one. So anyway, he's got this huge stack of airline safety cards, which we came across when we were cleaning out his room. So fascination with the aircraft, which of course becomes his career. He wanted to become an Eagle Scout, so he started Cub Scouts, worked all the way up through Eagle. The reason why he wanted to become an Eagle Scout was because he had read somewhere that every single person who walked on the moon had been an Eagle Scout. And so, okay, we're going to be an Eagle Scout. So, of course, there's an airplane angle to that. When there's a museum just north of Lubbock, near the airport, called the Silent Wings Museum, because this is where they trained for the gliders that flew in on D-Day here at the Air Force Base in Lubbock. And so they've got the Silent Wings Museum up there. And so he did a project. His Eagle Scout project was, I think, laying the bricks out in front that have got the donors' names on them, that you've seen that in various places. He's also went to Philmont, and that's where he got his taste for backpacking. First really enjoyed backpacking, not with his backpacker dad, but rather out backpacking at Philmont. He's always been interested in music. We always had musical instruments at home, piano. He started playing piano at Piano Lab, which is a school class. And then Aaron picked up guitar, and I think that got him interested in playing guitar. And then, of course, he plays both of them. He played jazz band and guitar at high school. And then he went to Rice, where they have a marching band. Anybody who plays any instrument can be in the marching band. So you've got people in the marching band playing their cello and moving the chair around the field and sitting down and playing it. And so he's got a little cart with his amplifier and his guitar, electric guitar, out there with the Rice marching band. He's gone on to, you know, play a bunch of different groups at Rice and at Stanford, and since then, I think, too. He picked up his love of dancing. I mean, it's in the family. We've got, its cousin Hannah has got a dance studio that she's just, going on 3 years. And in my mother's family, everybody dances. My mother, my grandmother, my great aunt, dancing was just like, we just call it the Bayer gene, because that's their maiden name. He seems to have gotten that gene, because he, in Stanford, they had a dancing, what was it, not a class, but this guy led this dance class, the ballroom dancing, taught people ballroom dancing. So he went out and it was, you know, Stanford engineers, you don't think of dancers, but it was very, very popular. Apparently the guy is very charismatic, and Alex learned all these steps, and he was a really good salsa dancer. We've got some videos of him salsa dancing. He's, you know, he's good at it. He was also good because he knew how to lead, and he was aware of his partner. So, you know, he had a was conscious of the partner. You have to need these two things in order to be able to dance well. It must have been, this is a change of subject, it must have been around high school or college when he started saying, I'm not going to wear any boring clothes. And his clothes became more and more interesting. I'm not sure when he started wearing probably about a dozen years ago, when he always had his little sport coat on, and he began to wear a hat. I remember when he wore the hat home for the first time for Christmas. He always came home for Christmas. We would always went to my grandparents, my parents, his grandparents, in St. Louis for Christmas. And he's wearing his little fedora. And my mom, in her typically oblique way, said, are you going to wear that hat inside? Her generation, men never wore hats indoors, right? So he's like, of course I'm going to wear the hat indoors. I don't think he quite got that, but. And then it must have been about a half dozen years ago when he started wearing the red shoes. I'm not sure where that came from. As I think the first time I saw that, like as was mentioned earlier, we would, the family would gather in Colorado every summer near Estes, in Estes Park. And we go hiking and stuff. And he brought only one pair of shoes, which were his red penny loafers. And we always go on a day-long hike up above, you know, some dramatic place. And it's like, you're going to wear those? He's like, oh, yeah, I'll wear those. So off we go. And we're getting up above the tree line into the rocks. And there's snow and the melting snow. And there is Alex and his penny loafers. But I'll tell you, it was not a, you know, it was a number of other people on the trail. Everybody admired his red penny loafers. And everybody else in their hiking boots and everything. And who is this guy with our red penny loafers up on this mountain trail? But, anyway, the red penny loafers were never the same after that. I don't know. It's like so many stories you can tell about Alex. Of course, he loved his cars. Just absolutely fanatically adored his, had to be this specific model, the 2012 BMW M3 gray with heated red seats convertible, so that he could always have the top down even when it was cold and turn on the heat full blast and heat the seats and everybody would be warm. In coastal California, I think you probably need heated seats more than in Lubbock, but yeah, and then he also, just 3 years ago, bought himself a 2020 special edition white Mazda Miata, also a convertible. So he just, California coastal roads are made for tooling around in convertibles. So he just loved it. This is a guy that loved life, was up for anything. Always seemed happy. Always seemed happy, whatever he was doing. And yeah, we will miss him.
Afternoon, everybody. Alex and I met when we were 11 years old. We both moved to Lubbock in the same year from out of town, and we realized in art class one day that we were both drawing airplanes on our artwork. We weren't supposed to be. And that love of airplanes and cars kept us together over the last 25 years, and to the point where when I'd go visit Alex and come home, my wife would say, "Well, is Alex dating someone?" And I'd say, "Oh, I don't know, we didn't talk about it." She'd say, "Well, what did you talk about?" I said, "We talked about airplanes and cars. We talked about the same thing we've talked about all these years." And Alex had so many great characteristics and lessons that we should all learn about the way to live our lives, with the enthusiasm and the self-confidence that he just did everything with. Alex never wasted a single moment worrying about what anyone else thought. And, you know, that's a lesson that I've tried to apply to my life. And, you know, I think oftentimes it's not enough or it's too late, but he, you know, so many things, like the way he was just happy with everything. He didn't worry about what anyone else wondered, but it did sometimes get him in trouble. And I can't remember, if it was you or if it was my dad that took us to the Slayton Air Show. I think it was the first one we went to. And Alex was there with his little point-and-shoot 35mm camera. And we hadn't even been there very long. And, you know, it was not a very big air show, so they didn't even have ropes or any sort of guidance set up. And we're standing on the tarmac, and there's a plane coming in to land. And Alex, of course, with his small camera, was not going to be able to get a very good picture. So he starts sprinting off the ramp across the taxiway. The people working there were like, "Whoa!" And that was just Alex. He knew what he wanted to do and didn't really worry about what anyone else thought about it. And so I could stand up here and tell Alex stories all day. We will miss him a lot, but I think, you know, we can all pay tribute to him by living our lives, by caring less about what other people think and only doing the things that make us happy. Thanks.
Anyone else?
Hi, I'm Charles Eggenbacher, and I knew Alex. I met him in high school. The group of his closer friends over here to my right, and I wore my burgundy suit today because Alex told me at DJ's wedding, he said, "Hey, nice suit." And from him, that meant something. And the first time I met Alex was in high school. And he stood out because he was the only person in class that showed up with a briefcase. And I can't remember exactly how I approached him because it was so unique. I said, "You know, hi," like, introduced myself, "I'm Charles, and what you got there?" It's like, "Oh, this is my briefcase," and he pops it open, and I think he always had an apple or a banana in it, is that right? One of those. Carrot. Was it a carrot? A fruit of some kind, but only one, and then the rest of the stuff. And that's how I met Alex Stahl. Anyway, Alex and I didn't really keep in touch often. I often would hear stories about him through his closer friends. I went to A&M with this group of folks over here. And but he did come and visit Seattle a few years ago, where I live, and I discovered the outdoors later in life, let's say. And it was not the best time of year to go hiking. But Alex, of course, he was only in town for a short period of time, and he wanted to go on a hike. And I love hiking, and I said, "I'd love to take you." So I take him to a short, easy hike just outside of town. And as it does in a Seattle fall, it was just pissing rain. It was awful. And I apologize for our weather, and it was just so inhospitable for somebody who was coming from California just for a quick trip. And he was bringing another friend with him, Nick. And I said, "You know, guys," because I was used to the weather hiking in that sort of weather all the time. I said, guys, Alex, I'm sorry, man, we don't have to do this. You know, it's fine. It's not going to be good. We're going to get up there. You're not going to be able to see anything. And you could tell his friend Nick was like, yeah, it's okay, putting on a brave face. You know, yeah, I'm fine. He's in jeans and cotton shirt, his friend. And then you get to Alex, and there's no brave face. It's just, Alex. I said, yes, let's go. Absolutely. And he shows up. They weren't the red velvet shoes, but they were these black clasp leather fancy shoes, tapered dark wash jeans, and in his blazer and a t-shirt, and he had a fedora style hat and an umbrella. And it wasn't a big umbrella. Probably standing at maybe it would cover you the whole way. And I'm there in my hiking gear and I say, okay, let's go. And I've got this amazing picture of us at the top of this short hike. And you see people, it's pretty common, it's easy, so a lot of tourists do it. And everybody's kind of having a bad time because of the weather, but not Alex. He brought one of his fancy cameras with him, and man. You know, we get to the top of this ridge. We've got this picture with, it's like, look at the view, and it's just clouds. And there's this side rain, and Alex is just standing there with a big smile. Rain's hitting him full bore. His friend Nick putting on a brave face, and me in my hiking gear. And you know, he sends us his pictures afterwards where he catches a ridgeline just where there's a short break in the clouds. He managed to find this beautiful shot that really captures the essence of, I would say, the beauty of the Pacific Northwest, that kind of, that beauty in nature. Even when nature isn't, you know, let's say, giving you the best view, he managed to find a good view. And having been hiking with a lot of people who are victims of the weather, let's say, and whose whole perspective can kind of drop with the weather, it was really inspiring to see somebody like that who didn't matter, you know. He was having a great time despite that rain, despite that weather. And I think that's a really good lesson. And I find that really inspiring. And I think that's something that hopefully everybody can take here today, is, you know, that Alex Stahl appreciation for nature and that general attitude that despite the rain, you know, be happy, appreciate it, appreciate what you have. So, anyway, I have more Alex stories, as we all do, but thank you. Thanks.
Do we have time for,
oh, yes,
for more? Okay.
Hi, how's it going? Wasn't necessarily planning on sharing too much, but I jotted down some notes on the way here when I was flying down to Lubbock. So if my friend Charles is going to come up here and cry in front of y'all, I'll do that too. But I guess just for context, I knew Alex from high school and from college. And so I had a few different reference points just, you know, growing up together and going through life. And as it happens with life, you know, after college, you go your own ways and you do your thing, and Alex does amazing things, and then you catch up whenever you can. I guess one of the most notable things to me about Alex was just the sheer consistency of who he was, like, deep down inside. And that's something I think I and probably a lot of people find difficult, is like, you know, who am I, right? Who am I, like, where am I going, that kind of thing. But Alex didn't seem to have that sort of issue, and that was very anomalous. Like, I don't know anybody, I don't know if y'all do, but I don't really know anybody like that. And that was that was a really important like data point for me in my life, like kind of an anchor in a way to, you know, give me hope that maybe I can have that sort of groundedness in my own life. So that was actually really important to me. So kind of like what Jonathan was saying, I think probably the best thing that for me to do to sort of honor Alex is to just, you know, try to live my life a little differently. So I just took some notes for myself. We've had a few weeks to sort of process what happened. And so here's just kind of a list of things I wrote for myself, but I'll share it with you all. I'm gonna ask better questions. I'm gonna ask more questions. I'm gonna ask these questions with less judgment, and with an intent, you know, to learn, and not other things, because I feel like that's something that we tend to do. We ask these questions and we have like an agenda. With one exception, so you know, just kind of thinking about that, one exception that I think Alex did exceptionally well was to ask questions with an intent to connect and to learn about you, whoever you're talking about, doesn't matter. And so yeah, just ask better questions, and then music was an important thing. So we like jammed a few times in college and did some talent shows and stuff. And I've always been into music, but like the way Alex was into music was very different, and that was also a very important like sort of reference point for me, in that Alex immersed himself into music in a way that I don't know, as I get older, I find myself, like, I used to play instruments too, but, you know, now I'm at this point in life where I feel like I'm on autopilot in a way, and Alex was the opposite. He would have an intent and act on that and take control of, you know, whatever passion he had, and in this case, I'm talking about music, whereas I'm kind of, like, on autopilot. I'm letting the algorithm tell me what I like, you know. Which is like, yeah, that's interesting, but it's not how I think we should do it. And Alex didn't do that, so I'm gonna do that a little differently going forward. So yeah, that's just what I plan on doing. So wanted to share.
Thank you.
Hey everyone, my name is Matt Rivera. Wasn't really planning on speaking, but I wanted to say a few things that I remember about Alex. I met Alex at Cavazos. The things I remembered most is getting that new Car and Driver magazine and then just, you know, talking about everything in there. You know, kind of exploring the musical careers in ninth grade when we, you know, took on a ninth grade talent show. He wasn't into guitars yet. He sang in our band. And it was kind of funny because we would just talk and he was like, I don't think I should sing because I'm terrible. We're like, no, it's okay, you can still sing. Like, let's go. But yeah, I mean, I want to say, like, Alex really was an inspiration. Smartest guy I ever met. And very, very humble. Always, you know, just open to talk about things and to kind of give you, you know, his perspective and drive new perspective in yourself. And I'll miss him. I'll miss his postcards, you know, when he would travel and ask everyone, you know, hey, I'm going to send you something. But he was a great friend. I have a little bit of regret, you know, not really keeping up with him later on in life because we all get busy. But, you know, when we had the chance to talk, you know, in Messenger or something like that, you know, we always talked about his cars, his BMW, of course, because that was his dream car when we would talk Car and Driver, right? So he will be missed, and it was a privilege to know him, and he inspires us to be better. So thank you.
I'm one of Alex's co-workers, but I've known Alex for a long time. I actually knew of Alex before we were friends. At Rice, he was very easy to notice. He would be in performances, and he'd be dancing in these performances, and he would potentially not look like every other person doing the dance, but he'd be doing it with them. And in college, you're learning how powerful this is, but you don't quite catch on until later. So he could kind of cut across the grain. Everybody knew Alex, everybody. And at Stanford in grad school, that's when we became good friends and roommates. And I learned a lot more about him there. And like many people have said, I feel very privileged to have been in that position. There are so many things about Alex. The way that I look back on it now is Alex was everywhere. He was so many things to so many people. He had friends all over the world. I know many of you could be watching right now. Lots of countries. He would always be traveling to foreign countries. He loved foreign countries. And he kept up with people in a very admirable way. He absolutely loved to listen. This is one of those things that I get stuck on sometimes, because you can tell that he's enjoying listening and learning. And he's not into turn-taking. He's into actually listening and understanding. And that just takes your interaction to a new level. And there are stories that I think touch a little bit on things that other people have said, but man, he loved those red loafers, and he would take them hiking. He would hike all over those red loafers and do just as well as you could imagine anybody doing. He enjoyed everything. If he noticed something valuable and good, regardless of where it came from, he lifted it up, and he applied this to his friends as well. He would invite his friends to come with him and participate with him. So Alex's relentless participation drew us in and connected us together. And he understood very naturally the positive effects of this, and he never held back. So he would always reach out to you. He'd always say, "Would you like to do this?" And it was so easy to take him up on it. And in so doing, you would meet his friends, and then you'd become friends. And the world seemed like a much smaller place because of knowing Alex. And because of him, I think the world is more connected. This participation was just magnetic. It made everybody enjoy what they were doing. It didn't matter why you wanted to be there. The fact that you were doing it was enough. And when it comes to talking about the company, Alex's aspects really inspired people who joined the company. And this, if I can just list them, they became the company values: respect, integrity, I would say curiosity and passion. These are things that he had every single day, and he was so consistent about it. Again, looking back on it, I just can't believe it. How can a person be this consistent? So he lifted us up, and in a very real sense, especially for the people who worked with him, he gave us wings. And even though he's in a new form now, he is still everywhere, and we will continue to rise and be inspired by him. Thank you, Alex. I will miss you very much.
My name is Jevon, and I got to be friends with him and play airplanes with Alex for many years, and he will be very dearly missed. And I'm just so grateful that he brought the sparkle that he brought every day and the zest for life into this, into our company and into our team and into my life and my family's life. And I'm so, so distraught that he's not with us anymore. And thank you for the opportunity to celebrate his life together.
Hi, I'm Alex's cousin, but I'm the baby of the family. By the time I came around, it seemed like all of my cousins were already sort of fully formed people, you know, about doing things in their lives. And I think when you're young, you sort of see people almost as like caricatures of like the things that they are. So Hannah was a dancer, and Noah played sports, and Alex had really long hair. but even, you know, I was a really shy kid, and so at Christmas when the whole family was there, I sort of wanted to make myself as small as possible and not be noticed and just sort of watch what was going on. And I remember Alex just sort of being sort of the opposite of that. He loomed large in a room. He was a full personality. He always had something to say about whatever was being talked about, or he'd read an article about something that was related, or he would have pictures to show of all the cool places he'd been. You know, it's one thing to learn about them in school, you know, when I was in elementary school, like, oh yeah, I like learned about China, but Alex had been there, and so you got to sort of see it through his eyes, and it just made the world a bigger place. And I think, you know, I didn't know him all that well, because again, I'm shy, I don't really talk much at family gatherings, but I think that sort of picture I had of him as a kid being here and hearing everybody talk about them as people who really knew him, that I think I was right, that he loomed large and he lived a full life, and it's really beautiful to have been here and hear everyone's stories of him. So thank you for all of your courage to share them.
Anyone else? Well, in conclusion, I just want to say that you know, Alex, you know, I remember catching up with him when I heard about his death through his old Quora postings, and they're still up. You know, and I thought, wow, this guy, what an amazing individual. You know, and he just quirky things. I mean, his friend, I think you were called, what was it? Four tacos or something like that, or four crackers and a bowl of chili. That was it. Yeah, that was your band, right? And that was really funny. And also the long hair. Somebody on the Quora asked, hey, did I meet you somewhere at a conference? Aren't you the one who looks like Jesus? And he said, yeah, that's me. I mean, he's just such a delightful person, and he didn't take himself, he took himself seriously, but he was never egotistical, never too sure of what he knew. He always wanted to reach out to people, and I was telling Mark and Lynn, I said, you know, when I read through his Quora replies, he could write about anything. He had and wonderful opinions. He really wanted to help people, and I told him, I said, you know, he was so engaged, and engagement is a sign to me of love. You are able to take the world as it is presented to you and be helpful and be generous and be kind and never authoritative. And, you know, I'm not a scholar of the Bible, but I mean, I go back to 1 Corinthians where love is the greatest virtue of all, and I think this is really what this young man embodied. And that is something that we can remember. It is a sparkling idea before us, and he brought that intensity, that light, that and that enlightenment into our lives. So I hope that, you know, as we go on, we continue to remember him in that way. And we'll gather now. We're going to listen to one of his tapes that he put together. He had a play tape, and I guess it was reassembled. And we'll have a reception and have some food. Stick around and talk some more about him. And we'd love to have you. Thank you for coming today. Really appreciate you.